Davey D hanging out with you this afternoon, and sitting in front of me is somebody who you should know. He's no stranger to our show, and he's somebody who has a lot of insight, especially during turbulent political times. From the Uhuru movement, we have Mr. Omali Yeshitela. How you doing, brother?
Good. Thank you for having us.
You know, I want to talk to you about leadership and how that's looking in the, 2013 and all the different ways in which people are manifesting that concept. That's a series we're doing. But before we get into that, I want to ask you about a few pressing issues, which I know you have insight on. Like right now, we're in the middle of the government shutdown. We're hearing stuff about the debt ceiling and all sorts of stuff. And the conversation that's generally taking place is centered around the quote-unquote middle class. And, you know, they'll go out of their way to find a farmer in Iowa and ask him how he feels about it. But what we're not seeing is what's going on with black folks in the hood and different communities. And especially where you all are at, you know, based in Florida, so you have a lot of rural folks. And I wanted to get your take on it. One, how do you see the lay of the land? And two, was this something that you were expecting?
Well, the problem is the way this entire thing about the debt ceiling and the closing down the government is being played, because what is really being played, is the people in this country. And both parties are doing it. Obama and the Republicans are doing it. And there's a grand bargain that will occur. And it will occur at the expense of everybody, whether rural or cities. And I say everybody, I'm talking about people who have to work for a living and people who would work if they could work, older people. Everybody's being victimized, because this is something that different sectors of the ruling class have already predetermined, and because they got problems, even though you have the financiers and other forces like that raking in resources hand over fist on the one hand. On the other hand, there is a crisis of great proportion because of what's happening in the other places around the world that you mentioned, where people are taking back their resources and putting a big squeeze on the amount of resources now available and the guarantee that these resources are going to be coming. And so this is in part contributes to this struggle that happens through the government, which is simply different sectors of the ruling class vying for advantage, economic advantage. And now what we have is the Democrats and Republicans, they're talking about shutting the government down, debt ceiling, sequestering, and all of this. And at the end of the day, what will result is a deal will be made,
right,
and that the Democrats and Republicans will agree to, that will result in, you know, they're cutting back already things like Social Security, Medicare, you know, right, all of that's on the board, all of that's on the drawing board. They're not cutting back on NSA, right, right? The National Security Administration, the spying agencies and stuff like that,
right,
the police that you will find in the communities, they're going to be there. To control people, and
and probably now even more so.
More so. So this is part of what's so criminal about it, because there's so many people who make the assumption that the only solutions that we have is choosing the way of the Republicans, or the way of the Democrats, the way of Obama, or the way of Boehner, and it's a false choice. In the same way, you have these shows on where you have a false debate between what they characterize as the right and the left,
right,
and you know what I'm talking about, you
right
know, with Newt Gingrich on one side and who's supposed to be
the
right,
yeah.
So the people are being played in a very serious way, and that is a serious problem that we have, with a lack of leadership, you know, that can help people come to better conclusions, and not feel and not advise the people that their only future, their only hope is to get a better seat on this sinking Titanic.
You know, when we last talked, one of the things that we kind of broached on was the topic of being prepared.
Yes.
And, you know, not just being prepared financially, but, you know, shelters and all sorts of stuff. And I've heard more and more folks who have come from different political parties. I mean, mm-hmm. I shouldn't say political parties, you know, former Panthers and liberation fighters have all been kind of, you know, like, we better get ready for a different type of battle, so to speak. And, you know, so is this another step towards that?
Well,
you know, economic collapse and, you know, resulting in extreme repression.
Well, I think what is happening is, and what we have to learn how to do, I believe, more effectively, is to contextualize what's happening in this country and in the various cities and states that we live in this country with what's happening in the whole world. Mm-hmm. And if we do that, then we can understand better what the forces and politicians are trying to do here. Because they've been squeezed by what's happening in places like Afghanistan and Iran and Iraq and Venezuela, all these other places. And it's really important for us to be able to explain to people that the political economy of this whole world rests upon the consequences of colonialism and slavery that has locked the majority of the people in the world in a situation where 80% of people on the earth try to survive off $10 or less a day, and some 50% off less than $3 a day. And if you're in Africa, you're lucky if you're getting a dollar a day. Now, this is a particular kind of social system that, and so you have 20% of people on Earth, whether they are rich or not rich, say like in America, Europe, and perhaps in Japan or something like this, living at the expense of 80% of the people of the world. I know you hear this, that we are the 99%, but it's nonsense. So what's happening is this squeeze is happening because people everywhere are taking back the resources and refusing to live like that.
So we're the 1% in context to the rest of the world.
No, not we are the 1%. There is a 1%, but the vast majority of white people in the world represent a part of the 20% that's living at the expense of everybody else.
Right.
Now what's happening, people are taking their resources back. That's why drones are being killing people all over the world, and there's a sense of unending war that and threats of war that's happening right now. And that's also why your sectors of the bourgeoisie are fighting like mad over resources that's reflected in the political arena, like in the Congress and the politicians, etc., because they represent the ruling class, you know. And so now with this squeeze on resources, you see this battle. And now you're right. The government and the politicians and the ruling class, they are really shaken because there's a crisis that manifests itself in various ways. And people in this country, and particularly Africans and Mexicans and other people who live under the hammer every day, because you say we want to cut the government down, shut the government down. Hell, as far as we're concerned, the government been shut down for a while in terms of resources, except for the police, you know, which is really the arm of the government that most of us are connected with every day. Many people who don't know the name of their council person or the name of their senator know the name of the cop that's, you know, in the neighborhood that's always arresting people and taking their children off the prison. So yeah, I think we will see an intensification of repression. That's what NSA is all about. That's what spying on everybody is all about. That's what the so-called stop and frisk, and you know, where thousands of people in New York alone, I think 850,000 people stopped in a single year.
Right.
You know, and then of those people who were stopped, the majority of them, I think something like more than 80% of them are Africans and Latinos.
Right.
And then only 8% of those were charged with anything. And what they were charged with had nothing to do with what they were stopped for in the first place.
Right. And they just had a statistic that came out, I think the other day, talking about canine units in Los Angeles, which you just came from, and they were saying that during the first half of the year, the only people to have been bitten by these canine units were black and brown folks, which is just crazy. Yeah. Nobody else.
Yes. But the problem is, and I think, I say a problem, but increasingly the world is changing. There's been a really, really major shift in the balance of forces in the whole world. And this is being reflected politically and in all kinds of ways. And then we've got a generation of young people who are growing up not as concerned and afraid of of the status quo of imperialism, of white power, of the police, of the assumption that you know, that there's all powerful enemy, as we may have done.
Right.
They are growing up in a different situation. They're growing up and not necessarily even without political education and stuff like that that's being directed at them by specific organizations. They see the Afghanis, the people in Afghanistan, fighting to a standstill, the so-called most powerful country in the world, from a place where people barely have enough bread to feed their children. They saw Hugo Chavez, and they see people all around the world defying this great power, and this is what they're growing up with. And so unlike a generation that grew up seeing this all-powerful white man, white power, etc., dominating everything, and therefore being intimidated by it, these are the people who saw Muhammad Ali knock out George Foreman, so he's not as scary anymore as he was in the past. So it's a whole different generation. And yes, repression is something that's real. And yes, preparation is absolutely necessary for everybody in order to deal with this monster that's been mortally wounded and acting like it.
If you're just tuning in, we're talking with Omali Yeshitela. Before I let you tell people where you're going to be at in the Bay this weekend, I want to ask you to weigh in on another topic, and that is, of course, top of mind for a lot of folks is the passing of Herman Wallace, yeah, Angola 3, yeah, yeah. The plight of political, yeah, prisoners. Your thoughts on that, and, you know, looking at this, you know, from a global perspective like you do, how do we contextualize that, starting off with your feelings?
Well, my brother Davey D, you know, there's something horribly wrong that's happening in this country. And I do want to talk about the Angola of forces and the brother Wallace that just died. But I'm in California, and you know, this whole issue of immigration. Here we are on stolen land, right? Land just recently stolen,
right,
from Mexico. Half of Mexico just stolen, just at gunpoint, ripped it off, took it from the people. And then the people who from whom it was taken are now characterized as illegal aliens for crossing an artificial border that was created by the thieves, right, in the first place. Now we got black people who occupy the largest prison population in the world, in this country, and the majority of the people in these prisons are Africans. And then in California, with the second largest prison population in the world, the majority are Africans and Mexicans.
Right.
Texas, Africans and Mexicans. So here we have the in prisons, you know, people who've been declared guilty, you know, by a court set up by the same people who stole the land, kidnapped us, put us in great numbers in these prisons. And now, you know, the people in prisons are the people who have been the victims of the whole system. And Wallace, who comes to political life, as I understand it, political consciousness, while rotting in a prison in Angola. And why is it called Angola? Because it's named for the place where most of the Africans were kidnapped from and brought to this country,
right.
So, and which is a hell of a statement.
Right.
So you leave and from Africa,
right,
and then they put you in a place named from where they just stole you,
right,
and you're in prison. And I'm supposed to act like there's something legitimate about what has just transpired, that there's something just, because you have a system now that validates your criminality. So that's what we're looking at every day. And these,
right,
brothers who came to political consciousness in prison, and who joined with the Black Panther Party, which without a doubt at that time was the revolutionary center in this country and in much of the world in certain ways. And you know, they have this brothers locked up in solitary confinement. What, something like 40 years, something to that
right,
effect?
42 years.
And finally he gets out and then he dies. And I think that it's an indictment of a social system based on colonialism and slavery. And the colonized, the Africans and the Mexicans and all of the other, you know, subject people who live in this country, and this horrible thing that's just happened with this brother, which is simply a manifestation of the conditions that all of us suffer from.
Right.
All of us suffer from. And I want to say this. It is our view, our opinion, that the conditions of existence of African people in America and in Haiti and in Jamaica and all of these other places are simply an extension of the conditions imposed on us with the attack on Africa that resulted in not just our kidnapping, but ultimately it resulted in Africa itself having these artificial borders imposed on it, artificial national consciousness where there used to be one Africa, now there are 54 different Africas.
Right.
And so if we are poor in America, it's not, has nothing to do with being shiftless or unwilling to work, or even because the unemployment of the economy is bad here. If we are poor in America, it is because we have, we're kidnapped from the land with the richest continent on earth in terms of natural resources that has been looted now, being looted for more than 500 years. And if you count the Arab aggression, you know, for a thousand, more than a thousand years being looted, all these resources stolen,
right.
And it's still being looted today. And so Africa, people in Africa are poor because of this attack. And African people in America and other places are poor, and we're stuck in these prisons just trying to survive under the conditions that's been imposed on us as a people by a foreign hostile entity that created itself, you know, at the expense of our freedom and resources.
So that's definitely how we should always see
that. We have to see it that way.
You know, what we're going to do is we're going to take a break, and for the people listening on air, we're going to continue this conversation with Omali Yeshitela next week. So I want you to tune in for that.
Right.
There you have it. We're going to take a break, and we'll be right back.
Exist in a state of vainglorious as we are protected by the red, the black, and the green. Heed the words of the brother, Sissy.
Let us the words, word to phrase, to paragraph. Heed math as Jay begins class. Science of past is now brought to the rhyme fix. From the scroll straight to the verse. God to God, from God to man. Many kings, many leaders, a fist from a hand. They call me militant, now what does this mean? Do I carry a gun to meet the army scene? With the cause I never pause, that simply is the brother. Raise the flag, wave the colors. Red, black, green with the key, the difference. Words make a way in the world in an instant. Living to die and I die to live again. 360 degrees. Comprehend, a man getting stronger till he's man no longer. Unearthly state makes the time seem shorter. The ever radiant awareness, voice forth the one. Open eye, stroke shun. Practicing priests, standing by what I teach. So you all stand starving as I start to unleash. Words of God. Brought from the Genesis, will exist till Armageddon is a witness. The originals built the earth. One must it be aggression to learn a basic lesson? Quite majestic, stern within reality. A juggernaut when you tamper with mentality. I wear a crown, extension and dimension of a brain cell. Bringing hell to the sellouts. The ever tangled web we weave. Always trying to obtain, no attempt to achieve. Defenders of kings and queens act like justice. Never potential, caught up in the measure. Jealousy of what are we? Becomes tendency for their thievery. Alright, cool. But no need to pull a tool, cause that's a fool. I get my words like that in my stool. To produce the words that they drool about. It's another way of taking out these sissies who may try to extinct my principality. But of course they're not having madness. From beginning, I'm the end. Observe me. Ignorance is not a trend. So as I beckon, for a few seconds, pull the reins and hear the words of the mother. Mastering words on the verse. Funk is a force I exert. Egyptian, African, now I'm on a black watch. Check my sundial, synchronize a clock. I can catch a shadow as the moon reflects the sun. Creator's eyes make a path of brother one. So now I walk softly and carry a big stick, a bird stick, so you native swing a lick. Jay brings the funk and spreads jam to the wheat bread. And the funk of this one vanglorious, unearthly resistance, strong with persistence. Grand verbal amicus, tribal connection, pyramids, witness the funk bearer. Vibe sharer, not the error. Brother is balanced like the scales of Thor. And even my demand makes stone seem soft. Corrupts all systems, positive poison of me. Some call it onk, it's a key. Black is a color while blackness, state of a mind state. But how many of you fake? Today, Brother J can find a better way, so be it. plan it down and make it stay. I serve a purpose, yet I'm not the G.I. Joe, I am the brother. Yo, I can never swear, bro, so just hasten your step to the mic and stage area as I drop the science that breaks the clock barrier. Words of old make me more than a beginner. The key opens knowledge and plays in the tenor. Americana man, Africana brother. Don't forget the land, cause the birth is from the mother. A vibe is in place, obtained and discovered. Tune in your audio and hear the words of brother.
Yo, Aristotle, Plato, Socrates, step off.
Tell these shorty, sky's the limit.
The sky's the limit when you know that you can have what you want, not take what you want. The sky's the limit when you know that you keep on when you keeping on. The sky's the limit when you know that you can have what you want, not take what you want. The sky's the limit when you know that you keep on when you keep
on. Shorty, I've seen how this life is rough because I lived it. I've seen how these times is tough. Fought the uphill battles against all odds. Strap your feet in the saddle, all praises to God. I know you want the good life and luxury cars. What you see is close range, and what I see is from afar. Trying to warn you about the trap instead of stab you in the back. You see, I never kick it falsely. I'd only spit the facts on how equality strikes at the worst of times. Soon as you try to ascend and elevate your mind. See, I was blind, being led by the blind, eating swine. Too wise, don't got me refined. Free my mind. Hey, shorty, do you know what I mean? Sky's the limit. A pawn in this game called life. I'm about to win it. It's hard for me to sit and see you do yourself when I'd rather see you do someone else.
You keep me up nights late, trying to put the food on the plate. In a ghetto black hole, unknown is the fate. Just a stack of rocks, unrefined black coal. Like Tesla, pressure, make you shine like gold. Cause yo, keep it real, man, a nigga gotta kill. Two niggas bust, two niggas blood spill. Blame it on the ghetto like Heine in the weed. But I'm damn it dead before it's fed to my seed. You bombard my baby's brain with the game, so he can bust shots and sell rocks with fame. So when he get old, he got murder on the brain. Only one skill, that's rockin' cocaine. Till the world blow up, that's the brand new slang. And it don't take much for him to pull out the thing and let it rain.
Can have what you want, not take what you want. The sky's the limit when you know that you keep on when you keeping on. The sky's the limit when you know that you can have what you want, not take what you want. The sky's the limit when you know that you keep on when you keeping on. The sky's the limit when you know.
We're back here, Davey D, hanging out with you, our guest, Omali Yeshitela. He is the chairman of the Uhuru Movement. And we've been doing a series, and we've been talking to a variety of people who are part of organizations, the heads of organizations, to get an understanding of the philosophy that guides you and your organization, the political outlook that you have on the world around you. And, you know, I always know you all, you know, the Uhuru for being a socialist, you know, type of entity.
Right.
For people who don't know, what does that really mean? What does that entail?
What does being a socialist mean?
Yeah.
Well, we are African internationalists. It's how we characterize ourselves. And right. We want to be careful about that because a lot of people who call themselves socialists are people who we would not necessarily agree with. And the reason we would not agree with many of them is because as we understand capitalism, which is the social system that will be replaced by the socialism that we're talking about, it is a parasitic social system that was founded through slavery and colonialism. And Karl Marx himself, who many people swear about, by actually stated that that capitalism, what they refer to as wage slavery in Europe, required as a pedestal slavery pure and simple in the New World. In other words, even the white working class in Europe and here in this country owes its existence to slavery and colonialism.
Right.
So when we talk about socialism, we are talking about overturning a social system that also roots out parasitism. If you talk about parasitism, you're talking about what Karl Marx referred to as primitive accumulation, the startup for the entire economic system that we know as capitalism, which came through stealing this land that we occupy now, that nobody talks about. You don't hear socialists, most socialists talking about what this land means to creating the capitalist society that they want to inherit as a consequence to coming to power as white workers, what it means to the people who are living in concentration camps referred to as Indian reservations, you know, what is the future for them, and what is the future for the Africans who created the wealth that they want to inherit after coming to power as this new social force. So socialism, if for us, it means the overturning of the entire rotten social system that was born as white power in the world and identified itself as white power in the world, increasingly refuses to do so, is reluctant to do so because more and more non-white people are coming, you know, are coming to our consciousness and coming to organizational strength. So for us, it means that the people who are the producers, the working people who produce all the wealth, because bankers don't produce wealth, and stockbrokers don't produce wealth, and lawyers and preachers don't produce wealth. All wealth is created by working people. It means to us that stage in history where the working people will become the ruling class and will be in control of the means of production of the resources that we create ourselves.
Right.
Yeah.
Where does that understanding come from? And also, you know, you said African internationalists.
Yeah.
So, you know, what is that rooted in? Is that rooted in Pan-Africanism? Is it coming from Marcus Garvey, Malcolm X? You know, how did you come to...
I think that we're talking more about Garvey and Malcolm, and I think that as opposed to Pan-Africanism, because as you know, Du Bois, who many consider the father of modern political Pan-Africanism, was adamant about having nothing to do with Marcus Garvey. And Marcus Garvey was quite as clear that he was not a Pan-Africanist. So we are not Pan-Africanists. And one of the big differences in the Pan-Africanist movement historically and the movement that was led by Marcus Garvey is that the Pan-Africanists were more an elitist, a middle class formation. In fact, Du Bois, who organized the first political Pan-Africanist conference in 1919, was at the time with the NAACP and was the one who had proposed and put forth the talented 10th.
Right.
You know, that the assumption that somehow the talented 10th%, the most educated of us, would be given permission by white rulers to be responsible for the rest of us. So we're not Pan-Africanists. And so we trace our linked to Marcus Garvey. We feel like Malcolm X, and even in many ways, people who call themselves Pan-Africans like Nkrumah, Walter Rodney, who we feel like would definitely be in the same camp, although they were recognized as Pan-Africanists, because Pan-Africanism only really achieved a popular base with the defeat of the Garvey movement by the United States government and Du Bois and the Communist Party USA and all of those others who attacked the Garvey movement.
You know, the goal of what you talked about, you know, ultimately achieving, you know, replacing the system. What does that mean practically right now? Somebody watching, somebody listening, what does that really mean? That what are the steps that people should be taking to get there? And by that I mean, for example, there's oftentimes a debate about whether or not one should vote or not vote, you know, within a system. You hear some people say, no, don't do that. That acknowledges it. Other people say, no, you use any weapon possible, and if that's a weapon, then use it. to that, you know, that one, do you start to set up your own type of society within a society? We often heard people, everybody from the Nation of Islam on down, say, you know, we need to have our own land and start being self-sufficient, sans the, you know, government and other outside forces. So in 2013, what does that look like as you take those steps towards that goal?
I think all of the steps that you just mentioned could be part of a general strategy for liberation. Mm. I think that I think it is incumbent upon us as revolutionaries, because our view is that we're going to take the power. It's not going to be handed to us. We're not going to be able to vote our way into power, pray our way into power, sing our way into power.
There won't be a grant for it?
No, it's not going to be a grant, and there's not going to be a poverty program that's going to pay us for doing this. But I think that there's a lot of exceptionalism by certain, especially nationalists and other forces, who assume that somehow African people are going to win our freedom without having to fight for it like everybody else has had to fight for. And people don't enslave us or didn't enslave us just because they didn't like us. It's been profitable. It has brought in a lot of resources, guaranteed the future for generations, and they're not going to give that up easily. So we're going to have to fight for it. But what does that mean? Part of what it means is that we have to be organized, because and the first thing that people need to do is join the revolution. In my view, they need to join the African People's Socialist Party and the Uhuru Movement. That's my view. I lead that movement, and otherwise I would join the others if I thought they were had the best solution. So that's important. Then within the context of being organized, then we develop strategies. We come to have a worldview. What do we stand for? You know, what is it? How do we understand the world? How do we understand getting in the shape that we're in now, other than, oh, the white folks don't like us? But that's not really helpful, because that traps a lot of people into either being in a situation where they got to spend forever trying to get white people to like them, right? Or coming up with some kind of way to segregate and separate ourselves from the white people so they won't be factors. Both of those, as comfortable as it may make some people to believe, that are nonsensical in our view. That it just doesn't work. Then what we have to have is a real understanding of what it is that's responsible for our conditions. And we say that what's responsible for our condition as a people everywhere is that Africa and African life, there was an attack on Africa that has resulted not only in our impoverishment in various places around the world, but it is part of what gave birth to a particular kind of social system. The attack on Africa, the attack by England, on China, the Opium War, where they brought in all kinds of resources, France and what it has done in Vietnam, and all over the place. This is the thing that rescued Europe from a state of 1,000-year history of feudal poverty and disease. You know, this is what rescued Europe and brought in this whole capitalist economy, world economy. This is what changed Europe from this barren place of warring tribes constantly at struggle with each other, who defined themselves primarily in relationship to each other.
Right.
This is what created a common identity among white people. This is how white people became white and became European. It was through slavery and us being made black and other people being made something other than white. And so you have the emergence of Europe, you have a sense of sameness, you have a political economy that is forged from enslaving and colonizing everybody else on earth. And this is what took Europeans out of starvation and ignorance and thrust us into states of starvation, sickness and ignorance, and a whole social system that's existed for a long time. That's what we talk about.
Well,
yeah.
Let me ask you this. You know, somebody listening would say, well, if you have a group of people that exist in the world that are poor, going through all this, you know, infighting and all this other stuff, what does it say about the weakness or the strength of a continent like Africa that it was able to be colonized and conquered? What does it say about, you know, other parts of the world that it was able to be colonized and conquered? You know, was there infighting? Were there things that, if you look back and you draw a blueprint today, you say, you know, this was a mistake, or this needs to be improved, et cetera, et cetera?
I mean, I've heard that kind of line that comes from, especially from some of the most noted black historians, you know, we shouldn't have let them in, that kind of stuff. But I don't agree with that. I think what we had in different places, and Cheikh Anta Diop, you know, who you may be familiar with, wrote about this, and others have written about this too, is that you have in these different places in the world.
For people who don't know, Diop, Senegal.
Yeah, out of Senegal, who was an incredible anthropologist, historian. He was just a great scientist, and you know, he's one who worked on this whole concept of the northern and southern cradle, and how, you know, in these different places, a certain kind of existence was imposed on people in part by nature itself. So you talk about the northern cradle, scarcity, where people, where war was almost a means of production, where having to constantly be at each other's throats and stuff. This informed the consciousness, the culture, and various other things in Europe. And on the one hand, on the other hand, if you were living someplace where nature is kind and, you know, easily provides what is necessary, there's a different attitude altogether, different consciousness. You learn to dance, you learn poetry, you learn drumming and stuff like that, because you're not constantly with your back up against the wall in the struggle against nature.
Right.
So to say that you've got people who, to say that if people who were warlike and engaged in this kind of struggle. I mean, that's where the word barbarian comes from. That's where the word vandal comes from. You know, it comes from Europe, where people are constantly doing these horrible things to each other. Now they turn against the world, where you have an open societies, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to be a different kind of society than that. I don't want Africans to be different from that. Where you have even what you call the so-called extended family, which I think is a misnomer, because most people have this kind of families. White people have different families, where the husband and the wife and the two children and the dog constitutes
right.
the family. But everybody, you know, in the neighborhood almost is a family in most other places around the world.
Right.
So you have a whole different kind of openness as compared to what you have in Europe. So I don't think it represents weakness as much as it was just totally... you know, something that that humanity, as we understood it at the time, had never been open to. Now we do. We know
right.
this.
Well, we talk oftentimes about Europe
yeah.
and the aggression that has come out, you know, in
right.
centuries prior to this. But within Africa, there was an Arab invasion
mm-hmm.
as well.
Mm-hmm.
And many people look and say, well, if you look at the continent of Africa, there's still slavery, there's still impoverishment, and it's not all the time because of Europeans, but it's also because there's been a disrespect and there's been aggression and invasion among Arabs. How do we deal with that? Because many times when we look at it, especially here in the States, you know, we side with the type of oppression that we, you know, see playing out amongst, you know, those who are of Arab descent. So how do we kind of parse that out?
Well, here's what we have. You're right about the Arab question. I think that's not something we should underestimate. For 1,500 years, the Arabs were involved in the so-called trans-Saharan slave trade, although in that 1,500-year period, they did not enslave and capture as many Africans, but it happened. And also, you can honestly say that there is an imperial attitude among Arabs often as it relates to African people. It's there, and I've run into it in different places around the world. But here's what we have. We have, subsequent to the transatlantic slave trade, the emergence of a world economy, not just the U.S. or European economy, but a world economy that dominates the Arabs, that dominates the people in South America, dominates everybody all around the world. So
right.
even the Arabs live under imperial domination. And so if it were possible for us to make a revolution and overthrow the Arabs and we'd be free, we'd say, right on, let's do this with the Arabs. But that's not the case. The struggle is that the world imperial power is European-based at this time. It's shifting in some ways in terms of they have more contenders, and most of the contenders are coming from the East in the forms of China and other things like that. But if it were possible to target the Arab as the fundamental contradiction, then I think we should do that. But I don't think that's possible. I think the real contradiction we are confronted with is the one that emerged as a world economy, not a relationship between Arabs and black people as such and trans-Saharan, but a relationship that emerged
right.
with the conquest of the world by Europe.
Okay.
Now, the issue of Arabs, and particularly on the continent of Africa, because that's been a touchy question. The thing is that in the Arab world, you have a similar contradiction that you have in the African and other world. You got classes in Arab. Arab world. You got these despotic Uncle Tom Arabs who are right now conspiring even to attack another Arab country in Syria. They're working with Uncle Sam. They're working with white power to do that.
Right.
They dog out their own people. They do that, you know, all over the world. So there's class contradictions there. Right. And many people, including black people here and other places, will adopt the attitude and ideas of the upper classes in our own communities, so that many of us, black people, have the same attitude about black people that the upper classes, and I'm talking now about the petty bourgeoisie, the middle class educated Negroes, and so, and also the white ruling class itself. We learn about other people and each other from our oppressors. So I'm saying that the Arabs are going to have choices, because Africa is going to be free. There's no doubt about it in my mind. But guess what? I believe it's going to be free in my lifetime. That's my job, to make that happen. And the question of African nationality is what you're really touching on.
Right.
The African nation. We believe that African people constitute a nation that's been dispersed all around the world, that has not been allowed to consolidate itself because of the intervention primarily by Europe. But there are Arabs in Northern Africa. And we've seen in the past, when the African Revolution was strong, when it looked like in the 1960s, when Nkrumah was the primary, was a primary spokesperson for Africa, not just for black Africa, but for all of Africa. We saw Ben Bella from the Algerian Revolution right. become African. We saw Nasser from Egypt become right. African. And I believe that that consciousness is still possible, and that it is up to us to give the definition of what the African nation is. And we're saying that everybody in Africa who's black is African. Everybody in the world who's black is African. Everybody in Africa who's black is African. And Arabs may be African if they are able to unite with the historical trajectory of black people to acquire black power and the unification and liberation of all African people.
Right.
That's going to be something, and I think that you're going to see Arab working people and peasants become engaged in this overall struggle that's also going to destroy the African petty bourgeoisie and kick them out of power as a part of the whole historical trajectory that I think humanity is on at this time.
You know, we've seen some interesting conflicts play out where people were kind of didn't know which way to go, starting with Libya, Gaddafi.
Yeah.
There were some, many who have been on the show that applauded Libya, thought Gaddafi was doing a great job and this needed to continue, and they looked at, you know, the Green Project or the Green Book and all these different types of things. And then there were some, there were quite a few people who were revolutionaries, former Panthers and others that were like, he's got to go. He's bad. He's bad business, et cetera, et cetera. I bring that up to find out, you know, how we look at somebody like him and that invasion and that eventual overthrow in Libya.
Good.
We also see how things were playing out in Timbuktu,
mm-hmm.
you know, in Mali, you know, and that was also kind of confusing because there were, you know, on sometimes we'd have conversations with folks who were black and Muslim who saw it one way and others who were looking at it and said that was black history being destroyed. So there's a understanding of classism, you know, and also the Sudan plays out that way as well. So how do you parse it out from your...
In the first place, the one of the critical struggles that we're involved in, you and I, black people all around the world, is our national identity. See, within a nation, there are all kinds of other identities too. A nation isn't just, you know, like Africans, they are also Muslims, they could be Christians, they could be, you know, all other kinds of things. They could be Boy Scouts. You know, they have other kinds of identities. The struggle we're involved in is which is the central identity that we have as a people. And the problem that we have is the fact that we have been dispersed and Africa has been carved up. And this false consciousness has been imposed on Africa, and then the fact that Africa has not been able to develop according to its own needs and aspirations, locked into places. So we've been locked into ethnicity, locked into tribal identity, locked into situations where religion is the most important thing, because we haven't even, we don't, look, in Africa today, we have a situation on the continent of Africa where from 3 to 7%, only 3 to 7% of so-called trade happens inside Africa among African people. That is, you know, the vast majority of what's called trade is being looted, going out to America, Europe, China, and all these other kinds of places. So you don't even have a national economy. And a national economy is fundamental if you're going to have destroy such things as the complexity of the multiplicity of languages and stuff like that, if you're going to create a situation where the identity can actually grow and not be limited, because the so-called ethnic groups and tribes, this stuff is where the economies have been locked in for generations. People learn to produce and stuff as groups of people in these narrow confines. So it has to be freed up,
right,
so that we can have a whole Africa and we can see the whole picture, and our vision grows as a consequence of that. And we have to have a revolutionary party, a revolutionary movement like what Garvey created, like what the African People's Socialist Party is creating, that has that vision for the people, that can lock the people into a new, different, broader kind of vision.
So everybody's on the same
Everybody's on the same page.
Okay. You know, I know we're running out of time, and I have a couple of last questions as we're talking with Omali Yeshitela, if you're just tuning in and watching. Women.
Yes.
How do we see our sisters? Oftentimes in the criticism, if we were to carve out new movements today, looking back at the past, they will point and say there was a lot of marginalization, a lot of misogyny, a lot of second-classing women in our movements. Even now, as we have conversations, there are people going, where are the women, you know? Mm-hmm. How does this play out? What's our responsibility as men? And is there a traditional role we're playing, or are we creating new seats and new paradigms that we haven't seen in a while?
Well, I think the main thing that has to happen is that real revolutionary organizations, real social transformation requires freedom for everybody without any limitation, without any attempt to impose what freedom should look like in that context, if it's for the whole. You understand?
Right.
Freedom for everybody. And this notion, backwards notion, that imposed on Africa from some external forces that somehow women are lesser creatures that have to walk in the back and know their places and this stuff, is bogus and backwards. And that what has to happen, and if you look at the history of our organization, you will see that throughout our history, not only have we had women leadership, but from some of our history, the majority of our leaders have been women. And this is not just in work, I'm talking about real power that has existed and exists in our party right now. So that's one thing. But I want to go beyond that, because not only are we talking about women and this notion about placing limitations, I think women have to join the revolution to guarantee what the future is going to look like, so it's not left up to me and you and other people, but they're going to be able to say, this is how the future is going to be looked, because they're locked and loaded. You understand? Just like everybody else,
one
locked
say,
and loaded.
One might say the fact that they bear kids and life and all that, and a lot of times in our communities are the backbones, are the ones that are shouldering a lot of the burden, and not because it's women's work, but just the practicality of us being at war and so many brothers being carted off to jail, by default, a lot of our sisters become a part of that. One would argue that they're already a part of the revolution, and that we need to, as men, make sure that they are, that their wisdom is included in the conversation, that their ideas and perspectives are taken into account as we form, knowing that if we're in a constant state of war, which you pointed out, the casualty is that many of us are locked up and our mothers and sisters and aunties are holding down the fort.
Well, that's true. But I think what I would say is that that is absolutely true. I think we have to build movements like that. But I'm saying also that women should not have to rely on my willingness or your willingness to open the door. I'm saying that women must join this revolution, and then when coming into the revolution must demand that the revolution opens up itself so that the children and all of these are factors in their participation.
Right.
And that men learn how to cook, and men learn how to wash clothes and iron and do all the other kinds of things that's necessary. And the women have to be involved in this discussion about what development is going to look like in technology, what it's going to do, because some of the things that proscribed certain kinds of participation by women in society in the past are no longer necessary. I mean, it may have been necessary based on physical strength, what women could do in terms of labor and stuff like that, but technology today, you know, that's not necessary.
Right.
You know, and I don't want people who, even when they're talking about how, you know, women, you know, have to do these things based on we're at war, I mean, there's some way that you can fancy up and gussy up and dress up and romanticize this stuff that women are trapped in. I mean, you go to Africa where you see women you know, walking for miles and miles and miles with tons, like beasts of burden, with heads, you know, full of wood, firewood, walking miles, you know, to get wood, to cook food, walking miles to get clean, get water, not clean water, to use for food and stuff like that. This is terrible. Like, you know, women are like beasts of burden. And that stuff, we have to have revolutionary movement. That's my commitment. But women should not have to depend on my commitment. They should join in this movement to say, we're going to make sure. And when I talk about women, I'm not talking about feminism, which is the bourgeois concept that where you have, you know, some biological predetermination about, you know, what the future is going to look like in that fashion. What I'm talking about is women, the most desperate, fiendish imposition on the rights and freedom of women, African women, is imperialism. The same thing that imposes itself on the rights and freedom of African people as a whole, the same thing that's already predetermined, that women, that children, before they are born, are going to be locked up in prisons and stuffed into, you know, horrible circumstances, that's determined that the men in their lives are subject to be in these prison systems and stuff like that. I mean, so imperialism is the fiend, is the enemy that the whole African revolution has to direct itself, and women in the process of fighting the struggle against imperialism must join the rest of us and help to lead us in dealing with all of the contradiction that imposes itself on women that we may be playing some role in facilitating.
You know, as we close out, do we have to have a particular mindset in terms of having a new system come into being, or do we need a new mindset if we engage in the current system? Oftentimes people say capitalism is the enemy. I personally say, well, if you have the right type of thinking, it doesn't have to be the enemy itself. You know, if I have $1 million, what would I do with that versus somebody who is thinking evil with that? You know, just to kind of simplify that, you can be oppressive and still be a socialist. You can be oppressive and still be a communist. So how do we look at that? Is there a certain type of thinking that we need to start orienting ourselves? And if I could sum it up, it would be the difference between I think we instead of me, I think us instead of I. That's my way of thinking. Is that something that we need to adopt, or is it really about a system change?
It is system, because I think the problem is when what you're talking about, I mean, we can have nice people. We've had capitalists who were philanthropists, who would give money to the poor and stuff like that, and a lot of good it does. The thing is that you've got a system, and it functions in a certain way. It is something that exists and can only exist through the exploitation of labor, of human beings who do all the producing. You have socialized production. People have to come together in order to produce everything. Then you got private ownership of that which is produced. That's what capitalism is about. And so there is a system here that we are talking about. We're not talking about the attitudes of socialists that might be nasty. Somebody said that Lenin, I think one of the you know, things that he said, will and testimony about be careful of Stalin because Stalin got a bad, nasty attitude. We're not talking about, you know, bad attitudes and individuals. We're talking about creating social systems and the systems themselves, like a system that's based on profit. That is the motive force in a capitalist society. And it doesn't matter if you got a good capitalist there. The system itself is based on profit, which means that even though you might give some of your money to the sick people, the capitalist system itself is one that you can't go to the hospital if you're sick, if you ain't got no money. You put yourself in a hospital, the capitalist system uses the state apparatus, which is the police, to kick you in jail, give you another bed. The capitalist system, even though you might give money to the poor, the capitalist system is not going to do anything with the food that when Lucky's or one of these other institutions have food that they throw away at the end of the day, and you got all these poor people who have nothing to eat, the food's all falling off the shelves in the grocery store, the capitalist system is not going to feed them, and your contribution is not going to be enough to do it, even if you're a nice capitalist. So we're talking about the system. It's got to be uprooted. And it's going to take revolutionary struggle, and people have to be organized and come into a revolutionary organization. And I think that revolution, for revolution to happen, we must have the inability of the ruling class to rule in the same old way. And we see that right now. That's why Obama is president. There must be crisis. You see crisis all over the world. Right. There must be also a revolutionary party that's guided by advanced revolutionary theory. If you got that, then you have the ability to make a revolution. That's what we're struggling for.
Omali Yeshitela, how do people get a hold of you, the movement? And I know you all have conventions coming up in December.
We have a major congress coming up in December, the 7th through the 11th of December in St. Petersburg, Florida. You can go to Uhuru News, that's U-H-U-R-U News .com and get access to all of the information about the Congress and everything else that we're doing.
Is it only black owned?
Everybody. We want everybody to come to this Congress. We're going to be doing regional conferences here in California someplace, and we want everybody to participate because we want the input. We are a democratic process in terms of needing to know how all of us are thinking so that we can have something that's legitimate, that's representative of the aspirations of African people, but also we don't live in a vacuum. You know, there are other people in this world as well.
Well, there you have it. As we continue our series of leadership and philosophies, we're going to take a break. Peace out, y'all. Thank you.
Thank you, brother. It's always good, David.
Trigger finger, trigger hand, and trigger toe. A two gun me have me bust them in a stereo.